Turn with us to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 5. And we want to begin reading with verse 38 and read through verse 48. Matthew chapter 5, verse 38 through 48. Ye have heard that it hath been said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say unto you that ye resist not evil, but whosoever shall smite thee on thy right cheek, turn to him the other also. And if any man will sue thee at the law and take away thy coat, let him have thy cloak also. And whosoever shall compel thee to go a mile, go with him twain. Give to him that asketh thee, and from him that would borrow of thee, turn not thou away. Ye have heard that it hath been said, Thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy. But I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you, that you may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. For he maketh his sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and sendeth rain on the just and on the unjust. For if ye love them which love you, what reward have ye? Do not even the publicans the same? And if ye salute your brethren only, what do ye more than others? Do not even the publicans so? Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect. And I want to speak on the subject this morning of going the extra mile. In this portion, Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, he requires that his disciples must rise above man's natural and common behavior to a whole new level of conduct, to do more than what is required or expected by man. Which we can sum up here this morning, and our thought is centered around going the extra mile. Now, as I understand Roman law, because Israel at this time was under the dominion of the Roman Empire, Roman soldiers were garrisoned there. They had Roman governors and so on. And Roman law allowed a soldier, if he can't, which usually when they were traveling, they had their gear with them. You know, soldiers today, they have duffel bags and backpacks and things like that, that they carried their personal gear in. And the Roman soldiers had their equivalent in that day. And they were allowed by law, if they came across a citizen, they could compel them to carry their pack for them for a mile. That was it. And that's what this is in reference to. They were legally bound, if requested, if required, to carry that pack for a mile. And then the soldier had to take it up again until he could find somebody else. And so the instructions here, if they compel thee, whosoever shall compel thee to go a mile, said, go with him too. It's go that extra mile. And that's where we get that phrase from, going the extra mile. And so Jesus kind of seized upon that to show that his kingdom, and that's what the Sermon on the Mount, he's establishing, these are the rules of my kingdom. These are the attributes of the citizens of my kingdom. And this is what I expect my disciples to do. And that his kingdom had higher standards and a level of service. Now we live in such a day that the attitude of most people is that they seek to do as little as possible. The minimum required. You know, they said, how little can I do and still keep my job, still get paid? Basically, that's what it comes down to. When the boss is around, they look real busy. They work real hard. When the boss is not watching, they slack off. Scripture gives us some teachings about that. Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 5 through 8 said, "Servants, be obedient to them that are your masters according to the flesh, with fear and trembling and singleness of your heart as unto Christ, not with eye service as men pleasers, but as the servants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart, with good will doing service as to the Lord and not to men, knowing that whatsoever good thing any man doeth, the same shall he receive of the Lord, whether he be bond or free." And so he makes this statement here, not with eye service as men pleasers. Don't just do it when their eyes are on you. He said, but all the time, and basically you're doing it as unto the Lord. Not to the boss, not to the master, not to whoever's in charge, but the Lord is always present. He's always watching. Now, you know, and we've seen people that they just slack off, but when the boss comes around, suddenly they're real busy and acting real busy and they've got things to do, and as soon as the boss is gone, they go back to slacking off. That's what he's talking about here in Ephesians, as eye service as pleasing men. Colossians chapter 3, verse 22. He says, "Servants, obey in all things your masters according to the flesh, not with eye service as men pleasers, but in singleness of heart, fearing God. And whatsoever you do, do it heartily, as to the Lord and not unto men." And it goes much the same thing. But he says, do it heartily. Do it with your energetically, enthusiastically. Do it heartily as unto the Lord. You're giving service to the Lord. You think of whatever task you've been given to do, whatever your job description is, you're doing this as unto the Lord, and you're doing it to please Him. And so you do it heartily, with enthusiasm, with, you know, with all your strength there. And then 1 Peter chapter 2. Skip from Paul now to Peter. Peter chapter 2 verse 18 said, "Servants, be subject to your masters with all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the froward. For this is thankworthy, if a man for conscience toward God endure grief, suffering wrongfully." And so he says, you know, not only to, you know, sometimes you have good bosses and they understand, they're understanding, they're not mean-spirited or whatever, and it's easier to serve them. But he says we need to have that same level of service. Again, it's as unto the Lord. It doesn't make any difference what your boss is like, but you're doing this as unto the Lord. And the Lord, you know, He is our master, and He is good. He is understanding. He says He will not lay any more on us than what we're able to bear. And so we're to do service as unto Him. And so if our boss, if our master here is good, then that's fine. But if not, if he's mean, if he's grouchy, if he's having a bad day, that should not alter our level of service, because it is not based on him, but based on the Lord. Notice Isaiah 55. And the thing, when Jesus was teaching here, his Sermon on the Mount, he was not introducing something new and something different. actually, he was going back and reiterating and affirming that which God had always taught from the beginning. And we need to keep that in mind. He said, I didn't come to do away with the law. He did not come to alter the law, the commandments, but he came to fulfill them. And so in his teaching, he was not doing away with anything, but he was reaffirming that which was God's teaching from the beginning in all these things. In Isaiah 55, verse 6, it says, seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. Now he mentions here the way and the thoughts of the wicked and the unrighteous. The wicked man, his ways, the unrighteous man, his thoughts. And verse 8, he says, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. Again, we was teaching in Sunday school this morning, and it was talking about the scripture that man does that which is right in his own eyes. The problem with that is our thoughts and our ways are not the same as the Lord's. And so we get ourselves into trouble. He said, for as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. He has a higher standard, a higher level to which he holds us accountable and expects us to do. We cannot therefore lean upon our own understanding and standards of what is right. And that's what Proverbs chapter 3 is such an important and prominent verse of Scripture. And we need to take heed to it. Proverbs chapter 3 verses 5 and 6 said, trust in the Lord with all thine heart. And sometime soon, I've got a message I'm working on that, on trust. It said, trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not unto thine own understanding. Our own the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? You know, he says, your ways, your thoughts are not my ways. They're not my thoughts. My ways, my thoughts are higher than yours. Every time we see where they did that which was right in their own eyes, there's a way that seemeth right unto man, but the end thereof is the ways of death and destruction. He said, lean not to your own understanding. He said, in all thy ways acknowledge him. And by that, he means God has said and given this direction. We acknowledge that by taking heed to what he says and doing what he says. Acknowledge him in all thy ways, and he shall direct thy paths. He will choose the path that you walk upon. He will choose the things that he would have you to do. That's what that is talking about there. So, what does Jesus require us to do? In the Gospel of Luke, chapter 17, and as we, from our text, he talks about going the extra mile. They compel you to go one, that's what they're legally able to compel you to do. Then go beyond that. Do more than what is required. Notice in Luke chapter 17 and verse 5. The apostle said unto him, unto the Lord, increase our faith. increase our faith. Now, Jesus does not give them an exposition on faith. At least, ways not what we might recognize as such. Hebrews 11, we have a definition of faith. Faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. The apostles asked God, increase our faith. So the Lord gives them an example. Said, if you had faith as a grain of mustard seed, you might say to this sycamore tree, be thou plucked up by the root and be thou planted in the sea, and it would obey you. Okay, now that speaks to the subject of faith. But then he goes on and he gives something else. He said, but which of you, and in some ways I think he's saying there is a more important application here. You know, faith is not just evidenced in being able to do something miraculous. A lot of times we talk about faith and being able to move mountains and being able to do things. We think of faith in, from the perspective of doing something miraculous. And what Jesus describes here is really miraculous. When we overcome our own selfish, depraved natures and rise above it to do more than that which is required, to humble ourselves and not think more of ourselves than what is appropriate, that is miraculous. And that is faith. And so look at this next lesson that he gives them in that context. He says, but which of you, having a servant, plowing or feeding cattle, will say unto him by and by when he has come in from the field, go sit down to me. Now you've been working hard all day. Why don't you go sit down and get you something to eat? And will not rather say unto him, make ready wherewith I may sup, and gird thyself and serve me till I have eaten and drunken, and afterward thou shalt eat and drink. Okay, now this is a little bit different. What does this have to do with faith? Doth he thank that servant because he did the things that were commanded him? I trow not, or I don't think so. Think about that for just a minute. Here's a master and he has his servants and they're out in the field working all day and they've labored all day out in the field. They're hot, they're tired, they're hungry. But when it's supper time, when they come in, he says, now I want you to serve me. And after you've served me and I'm finished and I'm full and I'm satisfied, then you can go eat. And the servant does it. That's what's expected of him. And when that has occurred, would you tell your servant, thank you? He says, I don't think so. So likewise ye. Now he's turning it and applying it to them. Here's what you should do. How you should think about this. This is how this applies to you. When ye have done all those things which are commanded you, now how many times? I got another message I'm working on. I got several that I'm working on, and it's interesting how that when you're thinking on these things, how they tend to crop up in other messages that you're giving. All those things. The commission, Matthew 28, 18 through 20, and he says, and teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. not just some of the things, not just the parts that we like the best, but said, all things whatsoever I've commanded you. We're to teach them to do, teach them to observe. And as the recipients of that, when we are taught, we're commanded, we're to do all things. Not just some of it. No, you give your children a list of chores to do. And you come and check on them at the end of the day, and the chores are supposed to be done. Well, did you get all your chores done? Well, most of them. Now, is that acceptable? He says, so likewise ye, when ye have done all those things which are commanded you, say, we are unprofitable servants. We have done that which was our duty to do. You didn't do any more than what was your duty, what you were responsible to do, what you were expected to do. I remember a few years ago in the conference, Brother Keller was preaching there at Mount Morris. And he was in the Army. He was a sergeant. And he'd give these privates instruction, commandment to go do something. And they'd come running back to him all happy and say, I got that done. Like they wanted praise for it. Well, what do you want, a cookie? Basically saying, that's what I told you to do. That's what you're supposed to do. You don't come running back expecting some kind of praise for it. That's kind of the way we go through life. We do what we're supposed to do. We want to get praised for it. Positive reinforcement. There's a place for that. But our mindset needs to be, and to understand and to realize that when we've done everything that we've been told to do, at that point, we're unprofitable servants. Because we haven't done anything more than what was expected. We did that which was our duty to do. And the Bible talks about things being praiseworthy. Some things we read, you know. When you're buffeted for your faults and you take it patiently, that's not praiseworthy. Now when you're buffeted for something you didn't do and you take that patiently, now I might consider giving you a cookie. Romans chapter 12, as we think in those terms of all things whatsoever he's commanded us to do, verses 1 and 2, Paul says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God. Now notice what he's using, what he's setting before us as the motivation, the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God. Wow. And that sounds like a tall order, doesn't it? Boy, he certainly expects a lot, doesn't he? He said, which is your reasonable service? I'm not expecting any more than just what is your duty to do. This is your reasonable service. When we look at what Jesus has done for us, I beseech you by the mercies of God. Paul's not saying, because this is what I want you to do. This is what I expect of you. But I'm beseeching you by the mercies of God, look at what Jesus has done for us. And what does it say? In Philippians chapter 2 says he emptied himself. He humbled himself. And I think that is the key to our attitude towards service. A servant, what does a servant or a slave have to be proud of? There's really not much room for pride, is there? But that is the example set before us of our place. You don't have anything, you don't own anything. Your rights consist of doing what you're told. Now that just goes the wrong way. It goes against the grain for most people, doesn't it? That's what he's talking. Lean not to your own. My thoughts are not your thoughts. My ways are not your ways. They're higher. And we need to understand that, accept that, and humble ourselves. Empty ourselves of ourselves. Humble ourselves and become obedient. Philippians chapter 2. Verse 5. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Now, Jesus on several occasions says, look, the servant is not greater than the master. If I have humbled myself and done this for you, then you need to humble yourselves and do this for one another. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Jesus, who being in the form of God thought it not robbery to be equal with God. That is, if anyone had something to boast in, to be proud of, Christ, who is God Himself, who is one with God the Father, who has all the glory and the majesty and the honor and the praise that is due to God the Father is due also to the Son. But he emptied himself. In verse 7, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. He humbled himself and became obedient. Why? Because that's the servant's place. That is our place. And that's what Jesus did. 2 Corinthians 8, 9. He says, I speak not by commandment, but by occasion of the forwardness of others, and to prove the sincerity of your love. For ye know that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be made rich. The grace of God. Though he was rich, he became poor. That's what he's talking about in Philippians. Thought not robbery to be equal with God. He was rich. But he made himself of no reputation. He became poor. That through his poverty, we in turn then might be made rich. 1 Peter 2. Verse 19, for this is thankworthy, If a man for conscience toward God endure grief, suffering wrongfully, for what glory is it if when we be buffeted for your faults you take it patiently? But if when you do well and suffer for it you take it patiently, this is acceptable with God. This is acceptable. And we read Isaiah 53. Verse 3 through 8. Said he is despised and rejected. We think of him. He became poor. He made himself of no reputation. He took upon himself the form of a servant. And being found in that form, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death. Now, what did that humility and obedience require and include? Verse 3, he is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. We did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. He was wounded for our transgressions and the bruises of our and he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shears is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living. For the transgression of my people was he stricken. Here we have a description of what Jesus submitted to. The mercies of God for us, that he became poor, that through his poverty we might be made rich. This was the grace of God. How can anything or everything that we do ever balance what he has done for us or be more than what is our duty and our reasonable service? And when we have done all that we've been commanded to do, we are unprofitable servants, because we didn't do any more than was our duty. So what we should be asking, instead of, you know, how little, what's the least amount of work I can do and have a job, keep a job, and get a paycheck, not get fired? Instead, we should be asking, first of all, what would you have me to do? And when that is done to the very best of our ability, not just half-heartedly, but heartily, ask, what more can I do? What more can I do? Now, here's what you said you required of me and you wanted me to do, and I've done it to the best of my ability. Now, what more can I do? That's going the extra mile. That is the work ethic that is lacking today. People who give lip service to being Christians and being believers are among some of the greatest offenders and being eye pleasers, you know, men pleasers, and giving eye service. And some will still question. If man only expects this much, you know, that first mile, and that's all that's required, why should I do more? You know, they're looking for a way out. The answer is that because your Savior did more than that for you. He went above and beyond. Matthew chapter 26. And verse 36. Then cometh Jesus with them unto a place called Gethsemane, and saith unto the disciples, Set ye here while I go and pray yonder. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. Then saith he to them, My soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here and watch with me. And he went a little further. You know, that is indicative of the Lord's behavior. He went a little further. He went with us as far as we could go, and then he went a little further. And he fell on his face and prayed, saying, Oh, my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. He was in sorrow. It says he endured the grief. He despised the shame. But for the joy that was set before him, he did those things for us. He didn't say, you know, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. We see in Ephesians 3:20, Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. Unto him be glory. You know, it goes on. But he's able to do exceeding abundantly above that which we can ask or even think. You know, we ask God for things, and he's not only able to do that, but he goes beyond that and does exceeding abundantly beyond that. Well, this is the positive side, if you will, to the child of God, where God says, My ways are not your ways. My ways and my thoughts are higher than yours. And that comes into play here, that he is able to do more than what we can ask him to do. And he has done. And so that is what he'd have us to do. We can't do more than what he has done for us. But we can do more than what man expects of us. Man's expectations are low. And when we do that which God expects of us, it's going to exceed what man expects. Now, to God, we might be an unprofitable servant because we could never repay the price that he paid to redeem us. But in giving that service that is due to him, in humility and obedience, rendering that due service, we will exceed all expectations of man. Man will take notice, and we will find favor in the eyes of man as well as in the eyes of God. 1 Samuel 2:26. We're reading about Samuel in Sunday school this morning, and the child Samuel grew on and was in favor both with the Lord and also with men. Notice that. He grew on and was in favor both with the Lord and also with men. Proverbs 3. Verses 1 through 4. Said, my son, forget not my law, but let thine heart keep my commandments. For length of days and long life and peace shall they add to thee. Let not mercy and truth forsake thee. Bind them about thy neck, write them upon the table of thine heart. Verse 4. So shalt thou find favor and good understanding in the sight of God and man. Luke 2:52. And Jesus, and this is talking about when Jesus was a child. And Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man. So he sets the example for us. He shows us the way. He's not telling us to do anything that he has not himself already done. Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and with man. He's shown us the way and has left not only the commandment but the example of going the extra mile. He went a little further. Not my will but thy will be done. He emptied himself. He made himself of no reputation. He humbled himself and became obedient unto death. And so when he tells us, anyone compel thee to go a mile? That's your duty. Go the mile. And if that's our duty, we should go that mile without complaining. And when that mile is completed, keep on going. Go another mile. Go the extra mile. Do more, a little bit more than what was required of you. And you will find success in this life. You will find not only that the Lord will bless you because you've been obedient to Him. And we're not, and this is part of the key and important to it, is we're not just doing it for the reward. But we're doing it because by the mercies of God, that is our reasonable service. And God in His mercy and grace, when we do that, which is unprofitable to Him, and think about that. If we do everything that He's commanded us to do heartily as unto the Lord, to the best of our ability, we're still unprofitable to Him, and yet in His grace He rewards us for. We shouldn't do it expecting a reward. We should do it because it's the right thing to do. Because it's pleasing to Him. Because He's done so much for us. Some people complain, man, how can I go an extra mile? Our attitude should be, how can we do less? How can we do less? Going the extra mile. It is a important lesson. It is a lesson in ethics. It's a lesson in what we call a good work ethic. But it's a lesson in integrity. It's a lesson in faith. Because we're trusting in the Lord. We're believing what He says. Faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. And so when we act in that way, when we do all that we can and more, and we still realize we're unprofitable servants, that's an act of faith. We can't see God. We can't see heaven. We cannot see the streets of gold. We cannot see those precious stones. We cannot see those places of abode that He has prepared for us. We do not see, do not have in hand the rewards that He has promised us, because the day of reaping and reward has not yet come. But we keep on keeping on doing that which is right and pleasing to Him by faith. The disciples said, increase our faith. And He's saying, yeah, you need your faith increased. If you'd had faith as a seed of mustard seed, you could say to this mountain, be removed, and it would obey you. I don't see anybody moving mountains yet. And then He gives this example. That's why. Where's the humility? Where's the obedience? Where's that sense that even at my best, I'm unprofitable? And we just humble ourselves and keep on keeping on under the Lord. That is faith. Going the extra mile is an act of faith. When you're tired, you're weary of well-doing, and you look at the road ahead of you still to go, each step beyond that point is an act of faith. Just keep on keeping on. And that is what the Lord would have us to do, and apply that in our lives and in all aspects of our lives. And as He has pointed out, when we do, it has its reward. We will get that cookie. Whether we ask for it or not, whether we expect it or not. David said, I was young, now I'm old. But I've never seen the righteous forsaken or his seed begging bread. Its length of life, its marrow, its health to our bones. It's all these things that men seek after and cannot find. Faith, going the extra mile. Let us stand together.